And I'm Jim Rick. Thanks for joining us. NBC's Blaine Alexander reports whether Americans think this is enough to stop a fast-growing problem.
This is the harsh reality of opioid addiction.
It was all I did. I woke up in the morning looking for anything.
It took my happiness. It took away, you know, what life is really about.
142 people losing their lives every day to an overdose. A 9/11-sized death toll every 3 weeks. That's why so many were anxiously awaiting today's announcement from President Trump.
We can be the generation that ends the opioid epidemic. We can do it.
The president declaring a national public health emergency, but stopping short of labeling it a national emergency. Joined by the first lady, who has made this her personal cause, President Trump speaking candidly about his own brother's alcohol addiction.
He really helped me. I had somebody that guided me, and he had a very, very, very tough life because of alcohol, believe me.
Today's declaration reallocates existing funds, no new money, and provides better access to medical care and addiction treatment. But the effort kicks off with several key posts still empty: a Health and Human Services Secretary, a drug czar, and a DEA administrator. Dr. George Kolodner has seen his number of opioid-addicted patients nearly quadruple over the past 30 years. Is this enough to address this problem?
A simple answer is no, and reallocation means you take money away from things that are even bigger problems.
But for the many victims, this is the biggest problem, President Trump promising to fight it on all fronts. Blaine Alexander, NBC News, Washington.
The president promised to speak about opioid abuse during his campaign. While reactions are mixed, supporters say any attention is good. Senator Claire McCaskill responded to Trump's announcement, also calling it a crisis. She says, quote, President Trump's announcement today is a much-needed step to fight the opioid epidemic that's ravaging Missouri communities, but it's critically important that it's paired with additional resources to help tackle this crisis. McCaskill has been involved in several congressional efforts to address the opioid abuse.
Families of addicts have mixed responses to Trump's announcement. Both health officials and families say long-term solutions are necessary. Some say their recovering family members need help that's constantly available.
This crisis, when they're under crisis, they need the help then. If they have a crisis at 5 o'clock on a Friday, come back Monday. How is that helping anybody? They could be dead by then.
These families are from Dayton, Ohio, one of the hardest hit communities in the opioid crisis. Opioids could not take one woman's life in Ohio, though, thanks to a young boy's quick thinking. Neighbors say a 6-year-old boy ran to their home to get help after his mother overdosed. Police arrested the mother after reviving her and charged her with endangering children. Neighbors say they believe the mother is alive thanks to her son.
Traffic on I-70 in Columbia came to a standstill this afternoon. It happened between the 63 connector and the Lake of the Woods exit, where the speed limit is 60. Police say a truck driver couldn't slow down in time and rear-ended a car in front of him. The truck then went off the side of the highway and hit another car. One person was sent to the hospital with minor injuries. Boone County Sheriff's deputies found a man in a flipped car this morning on Columbia's south side. Firefighters had to break the front windshield to get the driver out. Deputies say the car's engine was cold and the car lights were dim when they arrived. They say the driver was speeding and lost control on David Allen Road. After the driver was out, he was taken by Columbia police officers.
Here's what's happening right now. Citizen Jane volunteers are getting ready for the film festival that's opening in just a few minutes. The annual festival is in its 10th year and features only films directed or co-directed by women. Citizen Jane aims to get more women involved in higher positions. Only 7% of top-grossing films are directed by women. The film festival continues at Stevens College throughout the weekend.
After a Fulton storage unit full of toys was burglarized, students are offering help. Students and faculty at Fulton schools want to turn something negative into something positive. KOMU8's Adam Duxter is live in Fulton with the rest of the story.
Students first heard about what happened at the Toys for Tots storage unit yesterday morning, and right away they were looking for ways that they could help and make a difference. That's where they got the idea to involve the community in replacing the toys. Now, they're challenging businesses and schools in the Fulton area to compete in a toy drive. Students and faculty alike said the idea of someone stealing toys was something they couldn't comprehend.
It was just something that really shocked me, like, as I was hearing it, like, who would do that? It really hit me deep. I know there's people out there who are, like, suffering. They need help, especially around the holidays.
And, you know, you hear something that somebody has hurt a cause that helps other people. You know, first you're in shock, and then you're in disbelief, and then you get a little angry, and then you get motivated on how can I jump in and contribute.
Students from Fulton came up with to promote the event. They're hoping to get every local business and every high school from the Fulton area involved. As you can see, the event starts November 6th and will run to December 14th. In Fulton, Adam Duxter, KOMU8 News.
The 2018 federal budget has narrowly made it through the House of Representatives. It has already been approved by the Senate. The budget has to pass before Congress can tackle its $1.5 trillion tax cut bill. 20 Republicans voted against the budget, half of whom were from high-tax states like New York and New Jersey. Prototypes of Trump's proposed border wall were officially unveiled today at the U.S. border with Mexico at San Diego. Engineers constructed 8 different concrete and steel prototypes over the last month. They are between 18 and 30 feet high. Federal officials got the first look at the proposed walls this morning. A Customs and Border Protections official says technology will be an important feature in the completed wall.
Technology will tell agents and the response teams that there's somebody approaching the wall, and then things like digging and tunneling will be detected by that equipment as well.
Congress has not yet approved money to build the wall.
The U.S. Senate heard debate today on free speech, in particular the effects of controversial speakers and violent protests on college campuses. The speakers disagreed on what should be allowed and what's taking things too far.
We must embrace free expression, open discourse, and challenging questioning, and resist its suppression that we are seeing on college and university campuses.
We cannot use the banner of protecting free speech to allow people to terrorize folks.
Critics said President Trump needs to take responsibility for a rise in hate groups and violence. NATO allies are raising concerns about Russia's use of electronic warfare during recent military exercises. The exercises, which Russia held jointly with Belarus, jammed some European phone networks. NATO says Russian leaders' reluctance to talk about the exercises highlights the need for more transparency. A U.S. senator says bad decisions by Russia didn't begin here.
I don't think there's any doubt that Russian intelligence tried to divide us against each other and play an influence in the direction of our elections.
Russia and President Trump have denied any meddling. Presidential elections in Kenya are turning violent as police use tear gas and water cannons on protesters. The opposition leader called for demonstrations against voting, while the sitting president urged protesters to remain peaceful.
Tim's tracking much cooler temperatures in our future. What can we expect tomorrow, Tim?
Well, we can expect a very cold start to tomorrow morning, and it's all thanks to a cold front that's moving through the state. Right now, it looks like temperatures are in the mid-70s. It has been very warm outside. A few areas actually were in the low 80s today. There's a pocket of that 80-degree warmth moving through East Missouri right now, and it's heading towards St. Louis. Looks like our temperatures here through this evening will hold in the 60s. It's actually not too bad of an evening. It's just very breezy outside. But once about 11 o'clock hits, that's when the cold air starts moving through the state, and those temperatures are going to take a big old nosedive. We're talking highs tomorrow only in the low 40s, around 44 to 45 degrees, wind chills in the 30s all day tomorrow, too. We have some frigid-type weather, too. Temperatures below freezing for the weekend. I'll be breaking that down for you. That is coming up here in a little bit.
Tim, thank you very much. Forget the classic chart with shrinking letters. Researchers are testing vision a new way using preschoolers.
A third of Americans will get it in their lifetime, and now a new treatment for shingles is gaining more and more support.
And you're taking a live look as the sun sets over the Lake of the Ozarks on this Thursday afternoon. It's 5:08. This is KOMU8 News, first at 5. Coverage you can count on.
No, it's not. I promise. You would think so. Sometimes food can slow us down even when we're not eating it.
Researchers say it's harder to focus when junk food is in the picture.
This First Alert weather forecast is brought to you by Liberty Herbicide.
Junk food can be distracting, even when it's not really there. Researchers at Johns Hopkins University asked volunteers to work on a complicated task on a computer. While they worked, pictures of junk food would flash on the screen. The photos slowed people down twice as much as those who saw healthy foods, but participants who ate candy before the test were less distracted by the junk food. New government data shows Americans are lowering their cholesterol. Since 1999, the number of Americans with high cholesterol has dropped from 18% to just 12.5%. Researchers say laws banning trans fats in food and increased use of cholesterol-lowering medications have helped. Texas researchers have their eye on preschoolers to try out a new kind of vision test. The $6,500 infrared device could quickly and easily find vision problems. The four-year-olds don't have to call out letters like on classic eye charts, but they do need to stand still.
By catching them early enough like this, we're hoping that they'll get the vision correction they need and perform much better both in the classroom and in the community.
The machine can catch problems early on if students are nearsighted, farsighted, or have astigmatism. A committee of immunization experts has approved a new vaccine to prevent shingles. The group advises the Center for Disease Control, but the CDC has not yet approved it. The new drug is called Shingrix. One-third of Americans will develop shingles at some point in their life. The group says it prefers this new vaccine, and it can be used even if someone has already had a different shingles vaccine.
Coming soon to a theater near you, a ticket pricing test. Regal Entertainment will try demand-based pricing in select theaters. It starts next year. You'll pay higher ticket prices for hit movies and less for duds. Movies played at unpopular times will cost less. The new pricing plan could give theaters a much-needed financial boost. There are Regal theaters here in mid-Missouri, including Columbia.
Uber is introducing the Uber Visa card. It's a no annual fee credit card with benefits tailored to Uber customers. Users can earn rewards for purchases and redeem those for Uber credits, cash back, and a wide variety of gift cards. Uber credits can be used on both rides and Uber Eats. The credit card will be available beginning November 2nd and can be applied for in Uber's app and online.
UPS will raise rates in December. It will increase rates on certain services by an average of 4.9% starting December 24th. The popularity of online retailers like Amazon is increasing deliveries to residential addresses, in turn increasing costs for shipping companies. Halloween comes early in Massachusetts.
And parents and doctors are saying some of the costumes make perfect sense for these preemies.
Here's a recap of one of our top stories. Earlier this week, thieves targeted Toys for Tots in Fulton and made off with 12 boxes of toys. KOMU8's Adam Duxter tells us about a new effort by Fulton students to replace the stolen toys.
Students from Fulton High School first heard about the stolen toys yesterday morning, and right away they knew there was something they wanted to do to help. Less than a day later, they've come up with this, a Fulton-wide toy donation drive to double or even triple, they say, the toys that were stolen. Now, they're aiming this at every member of the community, from businesses to other high schools to anyone who lives here, and they're going to do this from November 6th to December 14th. Live in Fulton, Adam Duxter, KOMU 8 News.
Now here's a look at what we're following for KMU 8 News at 6. The University of Missouri released an analysis of the Greek system and the Office of Greek Life today.
The specific recommendations in the report coming up at 6 o'clock. Halloween is next Tuesday. A hospital celebrated with premature babies in style. The nonprofit project Sweet Peas teamed up with a Boston hospital to dress up the babies. Parents and doctors say the superhero costumes make sense, saying the preemies are the strongest little ones they know.
All right, and some chilly weather starting to head our way. It takes a little while for it to get here. This evening actually is fairly comfortable. It's just going to be very breezy this evening. But keep in mind, this weekend is going to be cold. 20s to 30s for morning temperatures. A freeze watch is in effect for Saturday morning. Here's a look at that evening planner. Breezy, 66 at sundown, 58 by 9. Tomorrow morning, just get ready for it. It's going to be cold outside. Morning wind chills are going to be below freezing. It's going to be a big contrast, maybe about 30 to 40 degrees colder tomorrow than it was today.
So right now up in Northwest Missouri, say St. Joe. It would be noticeably chillier there than it is.